I know you want to see me go home alone.
I'm done waiting.
I know you want to see me go home alone.
I'm done waiting.
This hurts so bad I can't breathe.
Thursday, July 7th, 2016, and we're back on the show again, talking about some stuff that we don't want to talk about, but we knew we would be talking about. It's very disheartening, and a lot of black folks, and I've even seen a few white folks, kind of upset with the events of the last 24 hours, where there's been three black men that were actually killed, one down in Tupelo, Mississippi, that didn't make the headlines like these other two, like the Alton Sterling and the Philando Castillo video, which is the most recent. And I just kind of wanted to talk. It's like we're beating this dead horse here, and it's always for me, and hopefully all the white folks don't get offended, it's what I call the unconscious bias that exists in this country, that a lot of white folks that are so unconscious to the facts of what is going on in America, and even if you try to tell it to them, it's just hard for them to understand, because they can't relate to it. This can't possibly be happening. This would mean that my reality is really not my reality. If black folks are actually being treated like this, I can't believe it. Here's a quick story, and it doesn't have to be on this level. It's on all levels of society, and I'm talking to some white friends, and they're telling me about this great opportunity that has come up at work, and this would really help your career. And I had to look at them and say, Really, so the last 17 years of stuff I did, that didn't help my career. Helped your career. I mean, you didn't do anything and you got it. I did everything and didn't get it. Same type of bull. You're living in this vacuum. And I've been saying this since the early 80s when I was in school and I explained it to the white people in the class. I said, we're living in two different worlds here. Your reality and my reality is two different things. You're going home to ice cream parlors and skating rinks. I'm going home to drug dealers and gangbangers. So my perception has to be different. And then if your only interaction with me is through television or things that you've heard, and now this natural fear has been built up in you. If you notice, a lot of these things are happening with white officers around the age of 25 to 35, and they're scared. I know they're scared. You can see in every one of these cases they're scared and they're shook. In this latest case with the young man that told the officer, followed all the procedures, and see, this is what white folks will tell you. No, if you follow the procedures, then nothing will happen. We know that's bull. They don't know it is bull. They know they can act a fool and still nothing happened to them. I've been an eyewitness to white folks acting a complete fool on cops. I remained silent because I know what was going to happen to me. I didn't say nothing. And unfortunately, that's where we're at with a lot of this stuff, that you're going to have to shut your mouth and not say anything. Comply or die, because that seems where they're living from now, because they're operating from a whole different base. They're not operating from the serve and protect aspect with us. They're operating from the I got to do what I got to do to make it back home aspect with us. We all saw the videos. The CD man. The CD man is dead. We know he was out there, you know, trying to make his money, doing what he do. We all know the CD man, the DVD man. We know how they make their hustle. It's 12:30. You in the hood. You got a little cash on you. You standing out there. You better have something on you, because the stick up man is going to get you if they can get you. See, we know that. They don't know that, because that's not a reality in their neighborhoods. That doesn't happen in their neighborhoods. There's no one sitting out doing that. A lot of stuff that goes on in our neighborhood doesn't go on in their neighborhoods. Or if it goes on, it goes on a different level. In the city, they may be selling drugs openly on the street. In the suburbs, you might have to go through the forest preserve to pick up your package. Or a nice house that's unsuspecting to pick up a package. But they doing drugs just like everybody else is doing drugs. They're just doing it in a different manner. And the perception is different. The war on drugs was basically the war on blacks. And we know the drugs exist because we put the drugs in your neighborhood. The problem becomes, how come we keep falling for the same stuff? We know what's going to happen. And maybe it's a lot of the father's fault that didn't raise the kids. I remember a situation when I was a young man. I had to be about 15, 16. And the cops swooped down on us. And cops slapped my hat off my head. Then he told me to pick the hat up. I'm like, I'm not picking up that hat. And he said, I said, pick it up. I said, I'm not picking up that hat so you can shoot me, because now you can say I was reaching for something. So when I didn't comply with picking up the hat, I got body slammed. Got a knee in my back, got a gun to my head. Hadn't done anything. But white folks would say, you had to have done something for the cops to come and do this to you. It's no such thing in their mindset that you didn't do anything and that a cop would just come and do something like this. But we see it on the video. This is the life we live. The cigarette man, Eric Garner. Lou Squares had just broke up a fight. Now he's dead. Really? The list goes on and on. Laquan McDonald. Alton Sterling. Philando Castillo. This young man is the one who told the officer, I've got a firearm. I got my conceal and carry. The officer asks him for his identification. He goes to reach for his identification and then he shoots him. Similar to a story of last year where a guy pulled into a gas station and the officer asks him to get his information. When he turns around to get out the truck, the officer shoots him. And the guy says, dude, why did you shoot me? So it's not as simple as complying. And they're all on this, I was in fear of my life crap. You got two burly dudes on top of one dude. Obviously, they got him restrained to a certain amount. But then they threaten him. If you look at the video, if you move one more time, I swear. Then he shoots him. Carries through with the execution. Then at the end, reaches into his pocket and pulls out the gun. Now, the stoner came out and said he gave him permission to be out there. And he had been out there for 2 years. He allowed that. Probably because it gave him a good little safe feeling of, this my guy out there. I know how you get down. He going to protect me a little bit. That's kind of how it runs in the hood a little bit, okay? You know that, but they don't know that. And they could care less about that. Because you are operating outside of the system. It's crazy. Freddie Gray, Sandra Bland, Oscar Grant, Mike Brown, Walter Scott, Tamir Rice, Jordan Davis. None of these people were doing anything. The Freddie Gray case, they really trying to persecute the state's attorney for bringing these charges. They've already thrown out, what, three? And now they're coming after her like, well, you might as well drop the last two because the other three were the more serious charges and those didn't go through. So now we're going to ruin your career. So anytime we stand up, we got to be punished. We got to be put down. And everybody should be sick and tired of it. Obama should be sick and tired of it. As well as the homeless man that laying in the gutter should be sick and tired of it. And every white person you know that's got some bullshit to say about it, you should tell them I'm sick and tired of your shit too. It's serious out here. Makes no sense. And the part that bothers us all, we saw Eric Garner choked out and killed on TV. These guys may get off too. That's the scary part of it. They may very well get off. Because if you're black, you're guilty until proven innocent. And that's the way they operate. So when I'm like this angry black man, I got a right to be angry. My people being prosecuted. That's what Flavor Flav used to say. We got a right to be upset. We got a right to not dig on your shit no more. Is this the revolution that we was all always talking about? Is it time to stand up? separate. It's been going on for way too long. Same speech and everything. It's crazy that decade after decade after decade, black people are in the same situation in this country. That means we have to change the way we doing things. Who's this? James Baldwin. I showed a clip in a previous show. And we're talking about the dilemma of being a black man in America. And when you say dilemma, that means it's a real major problem with being a black man in America. And no matter if you're successful according to their standards or according to any other standard, you're going to be looked at as a nigger. Ask Mr. Gates, that successful professor who was stopped from going to his home a year or two ago when Obama sat down and had a beer with him and the officer. Obama, you got to really pick it up. Let me share this video with you guys.
I was right. That's part of the dilemma of being an American Negro. That one is a little bit colored and a little bit white. And not only in terms, in physical terms, but in the head and in the heart. And there are days, this is one of them, when you wonder what your role is in this country, what your future is in it. How precisely you're going to reconcile yourself to your situation here, and how you're going to communicate to the vast, heedless, unthinking, cruel white majority that you are here. I'm terrified at the moral apathy, the death of the heart, which is happening in my country. These people have deluded themselves for so long that they really don't think I'm human. I have basis on their conduct, not on what they say. And this means that they have become, in themselves, moral monsters.
Well, Jim, I can see.
It's a terrible indictment.
Yes.
I mean every word I say. It was a great shock to me. I want to say this on the air. The Attorney General did not know.
You mean the Attorney General of the United States?
Mr. Robert Kennedy. Didn't know that I would have trouble convincing my nephew to go to Cuba, for example, to liberate the Cubans in defense of a government which now says it is doing everything it can do, which cannot liberate me. Now, there are 20 million people in this country, and you can't put them all in jail. I know how my nephew feels. I know how I feel. I know how the cats in the barbershop feel. A boy last week who was 16 in San Francisco told me on television, thank God we got him to talk, maybe somebody will start to listen. He said, I got no country, I've got no flag. Now he's only 16 years old. And I couldn't say you do. I don't have any evidence to prove that he does. They were tearing down his house. Because San Francisco is engaging, as most northern cities now are engaged, in something called urban renewal, which means moving the Negroes out. It means Negro removal. That is what it means. And the federal government is an accomplice to this fact. Now this, we're talking about human beings. There's not such a thing as a monolithic wall or, you know, some abstraction called the Negro problem. These Negro boys and girls who at 16 and 17 don't believe the country means anything that it says, don't feel they have any place here, on the basis of the performance of the entire country.
Oh.
I don't think, put it as simply as I can, and without trying now to investigate whatever the motives of any given Muslim leader may be, is the only movement in the country which we can call grassroots. I hate to say that, but it's true. Because it is only, when Malcolm talks, or one of the Muslim ministers talk, they articulate for all the Negro people who hear them, who listen to them, they articulate their suffering. The suffering which has been in this country so long denied. That's Malcolm's great authority over any of his audiences. He corroborates their reality. He tells them that they really exist, you know?
Jim, do you think that this is...
That clip is from the early 1960s. Malcolm X was still alive at that time. And the same stuff we're dealing with, they were dealing with back then. The question he asks and the question that we have to ask is, how am I going to survive in this country? Not how am I going to live, how am I going to survive? Because they make you accept what they want and what they, their infrastructure. This is the only way you're successful here in this country. And we'll take it and we'll give it however we want to. Just like they're trying to sign the petition. I think there's 17,000 people have signed the petition to get Jesse Williams kicked off of Grey's Anatomy. This is the first time I saw Shonda Rhimes stand up and say, that's BS. Because at a point, all of us are going to have to stand up and say enough with the bullshit. I'm not going to make you comfortable anymore so you can continue this bullshit. And that's the problem. We've made white folks in America extra comfortable. You can do what the hell you want to do. Fuck me over. Do what the hell you want to do. Kill me. It's okay. I'm sorry for upsetting you. I deserve to be killed. Another thing he said in that piece we just watched, they don't think I'm a human. So this allows them to behave in this manner. If you don't think I'm a human, then I can do what I want to do. Kind of like they did to Jews or they did to slaves. And you're not really a person. You're not even a tenth of a person. It's called unconscious bias. And they make it all right, and then they feed it into society, and then society accepts it. Let me share another clip with you all about this unconscious bias.
You know, right now where we are in the world, we really need to work together. And so we have all kinds of folks trying to work together, trying to work against this battle or win that battle or build this community and break down and dismantle, you know, communities that aren't serving us. But what gets in the way every time is race.
There's unconscious bias that's built into our brains because we have really, as human beings, for hundreds and thousands of years, absorbed messages about who belongs at the top of the racial hierarchy and who belongs at the bottom.
I was born in Medford, Oregon.
I'm foremost talking about the reality that culture informs everything that we do, and that most white people, because we live in a country where we see ourselves everywhere in every way, and our culture is validated everywhere and in every way, we don't understand how our cultural values are brought into the classroom. So when a white boy walks in the room, we understand him. We have similar cultural values. We understand how to behave, how to talk, how to respond to one another. If I'm a white woman and he's a white boy, he can see me as his mother. I can see him as my child. That positions him to know not only that he's right in the world, but that he deserves to feel comfortable, and that he is really claiming his rightful place in the world to be a leader. White boy who walks in the room and is that we are afraid of these young boys, and I'm talking young boys, 4 years old and above, and that instead of the teacher looking at him or herself and saying, what is going on with me, that this same behavior creates fear in me instead of admiration, we pathologize the boy of color.
Are white people scared of black people? Or are they afraid of the unknown? As that woman described, she said it's the culture informs what we do and it gives us validation. So the way we interact with our kids and we see our kids, we can relate to them. They deserve to be comfortable, and they're stepping into their right place in society. But when we see the black kid exhibiting the same behavior as the white kid, we gotta watch this dude. What's he up to? These are those unconscious biases that have been fed into the society for years and years and years. Oh, black people are lazy, this and this and this. But we were slaves for 300 years while they sat on their tails and didn't get paid for it. And they not going to pay us for it. And they not going to say America did something wrong. Everybody else did something wrong. The Germans did something wrong. Japanese did something wrong. Everybody did something wrong except America. But that's the sickness that we have to deal with. And then we still have to sit here and put our kids in these schools and spend all this money so they can get up and go to work every day and deal with the same crap that we've been dealing with. See, that's the system that we have to break. Try it one day. Call some white people on this shit. It's amazing the way they shut down or rewrote the story. And if it's not you, why are you getting offended? Why are you getting offended? If you're a good white person, then great. Need more like you. Some of my best friends are white. We're not talking about you, but we may be talking about your uncle or your cousin or your friend that gets a job knowing damn well he didn't deserve a job and gets promoted and gets fast line through a company. No, you're just taking your right position because your family has worked so you can have this opportunity for this position. I don't know how many people watch my PhDs in poverty. And like I always say, if the country's suffering, we're suffering more. If unemployment is 6% for the nation, it's 12 to 18% for black people. But we keep buying into the system. We keep saying, if I do this, maybe if I do this, this will work. So we try, not realizing we're dealing with moral monsters. As Baldwin said, you create all these things. You call it opportunities. You say, go fight for these people. Fight for your nation. But then you come back home and you're treating us like crap. We can't be liberated in our own country. Everybody got mad when Ali said, I'm not going over there to fight them people because people have done nothing to me. I want to fight somebody. I'll stay right here and fight the people, the government, who's oppressing me. You my oppressor when I need something. You my oppressor when I try to stand up. Were these words lost on everybody's ears? The only way this changes is if we change our attitudes. And this ain't no race talk. This is, maybe it's time for us to get our shit together. But we're so integrated. This is what all these marches and things were to integrate. Maybe we shouldn't have been integrated. Maybe we should have been like, let us have our shit. Let us do what we need to do with our shit. And then y'all do what y'all want to do with y'all's. But they said, we gave you your freedom. You expect more than that? They had programs. They use up programs. Then they give you the program and say that you're the abuser of the program. Even before Rhonda got in, he's giving all these speeches about we need to cut this program because this person's abusing, this person's abusing. By the time a program gets down to the poor people, it's been thoroughly abused already. Believe that. Politics is the biggest art of bullshit that you'll ever experience. And they'll spin doctor it every day and they'll tell you whatever they figure you need to know. And then they'll raise the taxes on you. They don't care when one of these black boys get put out here in the streets and they got to pay. Because you know who actually paying? You paying. The taxpayers are paying. That's how crooked the system is. I don't have a lot of solutions. I listen to a lot of brothers and I'm trying to get my own thing situated the way I want to get it so I can get out of this corporate America structure. So I can have some freedom so I can chicken George and do something for my family. And when I say family, I'm talking about maybe we all can build something together. Start depending more on each other. We call each other brothers and sisters because we're disconnected. Let's reconnect. Love, peace. So, we out of here.
Stay with me. We got pulled over for a busted tail light in the back. And the police just, he's covered. They killed my boyfriend. He's licensed, he's licensed to carry. He was trying to get out his ID and his wallet out his pocket. And he let the officer know that he had a firearm and he was reaching for his wallet. And the officer just shot him in his arm. We're waiting for Beck. I will, sir. No worries. I will.
Fuck!
He just shot his arm off. We got pulled over on Larpiner.
I told him not to reach for it. I told him to get his hand out.
You told him to get his ID, sir, and his driver's license. Oh my God, please don't tell me he's dead.
Hey, boss.
The girl came over to us and she gave us a bag of baby shit.
Damn.
Alright, right,
stop.
Give us your hands, buddy.
Put your hand behind your back. I can't breathe.
Come right over here. This right here says a warning. You started creating the problems.
You asked me what was wrong.
Do you have anything on your person that's illegal?
Do it feel like I got anything on me? This is a fucking maxi dress.
I'm going to remove your glasses.
This is a maxi dress.
Come on over here.
What do you have on me? Fucking asshole. You're about to break my wrist. Can you stop? You are about to fucking break my wrist. Stop.
Stop now. Stop it.
Stop resisting, man.
If you would stop, and I would tell you.
My fucking traffic.
Now stop.